Retro.
Hi, this is Vanessa Marshall, voice of Hera and Rook Cast, and you're listening to Dennis and Jay on Podcast Stardust. Their behavior is continually unexpected.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Hello, Star Wars fans. Welcome to Podcast Stardust. This is the fully armed and operational podcast dedicated to Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And in this episode, we'll be looking at the third episode of Season 2 of The Bad Batch. But before we get into our discussion, Jay, can you remind everybody where we can be found on social media, please?
Oh, I was just starting to eat my breakfast. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust.
All right. The dish is aligned. The signal's boosted to maximum output. The shield is down, and we are now broadcasting to the galaxy. This is our discussion of The Bad Batch, The Solitary Clone, which is episode 3 of season 2 of The Bad Batch. And this will be a full spoiler discussion. So with that out of the way, Jay, you want to go ahead and give us our high-level summary for this episode, please?
Of course. Here we go. When Separatist insurgents on Desix refuse to accept Imperial Governor Groton and take him hostage, Admiral Rampart assigns Crosshair to Commander Cody's squad with orders to rescue the governor. They meet fierce resistance from battle droids on Desix, but successfully fight their way to the tower where Groton is held. Although Cody convinces the planetary governor to release Groton, Groton demands the execution of Desix's governor. After Cody exhibits reluctance, Crosshair shoots her. Back on Coruscant, Crosshair is assigned to a new clone commander by Rampart after learning that Cody has gone AWOL.
Yeah, and so this was a surprise. I was not expecting an episode that did not feature our core group of Hunter, Tech, Wrecker, Echo, and Omega. You know, they're completely absent from this episode. I kept expecting them to show up at some point in this, but that's not true. About halfway through, I gave up on that idea. But what did you think about this episode that featured Crosshair and was absent of the rest of the Clone Force 99?
I was actually super happy about it. And as much as I, as you said, we missed seeing the core group, we've also missed Crosshair. And so, you know, I just think that it makes sense to sort of flip-flop the attention and see what's going on the other side of the coin, so to speak. And Crosshair definitely deserved a whole episode and what was going on, and just the punctuation mark of, you know, having Cody here and then him going AWOL. And gosh, I mean, there were some great things that harken back to the Clone Wars in this that really do help put some puzzle pieces together and are great little Easter eggs for things. But I was very satisfied with this episode.
Oh yeah. Yeah. It's a simply fantastic episode. So yeah. Let's kind of talk about some of the key elements of this. You know, first up, we get the Empire on their shuttle headed towards Desix, and Governor Groton's there, and he's got a squad of stormtroopers with him. What do you think of the stormtroopers' armor in this?
It was a little goofy looking to me in some ways. Like, I don't know. It just didn't seem like it was maybe as put together as what we are normally used to. It's almost like somebody just said, oh yeah, we got to get these guys in armor, and so we're just going to just kind of throw it together. I don't know. It just didn't sit right with me. What about you?
I thought it was actually an inspired design, like maybe what a stormtrooper would have looked like if Star Wars came out in the 60s. As opposed to the 70s.
Okay.
And so, you know, we've had an evolution of the clone armor over the course of the movies and the Clone Wars, the animated series. And now we're getting an evolution of the stormtrooper armor here. And so this is kind of like another step between the clone armor and the stormtrooper armor. But I don't know if that was the intent, and we'll have to check and see if there's an episode guide on this sometime next week to confirm it. But again, it just seemed like they thought, well, what would a generation of stormtrooper armor look like before the Stormtrooper armor we got in A New Hope came out. And for that reason, I liked it. It's not as impressive as the regular Stormtrooper armor or any of the clone armor for that matter. But I do think there was a definite design decision made there to show it as some sort of a bridge type of a thing.
Oh, I think that's a really smart thing to point out. And, you know, I'm sure you're right on that because it does make sense. I mean, there's a transitionary period in there. And so I guess I was looking at it from the aspect that that transition was a little bit more of an afterthought and disarray. But now that you say that that way, I can definitely see where you're coming from on that.
Mm-hmm. And then we get to meet the planetary governor Desix was a separatist world. And this was Tawni Ames. And when she shows up, she's got her voice modulated because she's got a helmet on. Although it's not the same costume, this kind of remind me of Zori from The Rise of Skywalker. And it's interesting that they're going to that well, and that may sound derogatory, but it's not meant to be. But just kind of showing that characters wearing these head apparatus that changes their voice and protects them along with these other costumes is something of a norm in the Star Wars galaxy. And it's becoming more and more of a norm the more Star Wars we get.
It is. And yes, and again, you took those right out of my brain pan there with thinking about Zori Bliss. And again, it's just another way to conceal that identity. I was kind of a little surprised, I will say, that she ended up pulling off her helmet. I mean, I guess in some ways I'm not, because it is an animated series, and even Kylo Ren pulls off his helmet and we get to see the person underneath. But there's just something of an anonymity factor to that that would have been kind of cool to keep. Mm-hmm. But then you also get to feel a little bit more of that humanity, especially when it comes to the end. You know, as we said in the summary, when she gets executed, you tend to feel for her a little bit more because you can see that face. But I was so enthralled by the voice that I had to look up who the voice actress was, mm-hmm. because I kept thinking to myself, I know that voice. That voice sounds so familiar. Did you happen to look it up at all?
I did, but go ahead and share who it is with us.
Okay. So, well, there's a few actually, but the most recent is Venicia Doza from Star Wars Resistance. Mm-hmm. And so the actress is Tasia Valenza. And she's also done Shaak Ti. She's done Aura Singh. She's done some video games and whatnot. Did you find any other ones that I hadn't mentioned?
No, those are the ones that I saw listed on Wikipedia when I looked her up.
Okay, awesome.
Yeah, no, I was the same. I was like, this is driving me crazy. And then with a name like Tawni Ames, it's similar enough to other things of Star Wars. Like, have we seen this character before? But no,
right.
This is a brand new character. Now, we do find out that she was colleagues with what's her name? The separatist senator that was working on
Mina Bonteri.
Yeah, Mina, that was working on that peace agreement with Padme all those mm-hmm. years ago. And so, you know, now this leads me to another discussion here. You know, she realized then, is what she tells everyone, that when the chancellor rejected their peace proposal back then, that she knew there was never going to be a peaceful solution to the war between the Republic and the Separatists, and that peace was really kind of a dead thing, paraphrasing for her. And she also says a couple times on this, like, you know, she knows that the Empire was never going to come to negotiate and that there wasn't going to be a peaceful resolution to this. And so that's why she has her battle droids go out with their rocket launchers and shoot down the shuttle. Do you think she ever thought she was going to get her way? And that she was going to get Desix's independence recognized in this? Or did she see this as an inevitability and she was trying to make a mark or send an example or show something to the rest of the galaxy? What are your thoughts on her motivations in this one?
Well, I would say that she really did believe that she was going to be able to stay away from the Empire because she had the firepower to do it. I mean, she had all of those battle droids and the assassin droids and even the tactical droids. I mean, like one like Kalani, I was like, oh, that's so awesome. And then all the tanks and everything. So she definitely had some good armor to be able to fortify herself. I don't know if maybe she was a little delusional in that way. I don't know if she really felt that it was worthless, because if that's the case, then she wouldn't have maybe put up the fight in the first place. But what do you think?
Well, this is a saying, she knew the Empire was coming, kind of like the way Sid said that the Empire is eventually going to show up at Ord Mantell. And when they do, she's going to have to shut things down. And that's going to be the end of the gravy train for the Bad Batch. In this case, the Empire was coming. And even though Desix is a remote world in the Outer Rim, at best, I think maybe her thought was that if I can kidnap their governor, I can make them see reason and we can negotiate something. But I don't think she put a whole lot of stock in that. I think maybe she saw this as inevitable, but that force of droids and tanks she had was not all that big. I mean, a half dozen clones took them all out, and these are clones that just got shot out of the sky on top of that. So it's not like she had that impressive a force to resist the Empire. But curiously, once she was dead, the Empire showed up with a Star Destroyer or Jedi or Republic cruiser, a former one, Acclimator cruiser, I think is what they called. And, then they started landing more troops. So, why they just did that from begin with, I don't know. Can't believe that they actually valued Governor Groton's life that much. He seems like just another tool in the Empire's tool chest. But I can't help but wonder if she was looking for, she knew she couldn't protect all of her people that, she represented on that world. So she was looking for something, hopefully to gain some sort of advantage to find a better life for them. Because what happens at the end of this, once she's dead and gone and Governor Groton's in charge, all the citizens start getting rounded up and we start seeing them carry all their valuables off under the gaze of stormtroopers. We just had, the two-part opening where, they were trying to get the war chest, which was stuff that was stolen from worlds inside the Confederacy.
Right.
And now it's happening again here.
Right. And what I think was striking to me as well is that I think there's a lot of parallels between Desix and Ferrix in that, you've got this population of people who are very proud. They don't come from a really affluent type of a population or, somewhere like Coruscant or, even Chandrilla or anywhere like that. But they're very proud of who they are. They're very proud of what they do. We even saw that on Ferrix where the Imperial occupation started coming in and people were resisting. And it was because that's what they valued. And so I think that's kind of what it comes down to for Tawni. And what I was trying to get at in a very messy way is that, she wanted to put up as much of a fight as she could, even though in the end, it may have been all for naught.
Right. Yeah. And she didn't stand a chance. And I think, you could see the resignation in her face there at the end when Groton essentially betrayed Cody there. Cody had made this really great speech about, we just survived this war where a lot of people were killed. It was bloody. Let's not get involved in another one. And that convinced her to let Groton go. And Cody put down his gun. And then Groton is immediately, execute her. Good job, execute her. Completely betrayed all the work that Cody done. And there was no reason that they had to kill her other than Groton was embarrassed by the whole thing.
Yeah. Exactly.
And so, it's just another one of these Imperial governors or officers that's a complete weasel when it comes down to it.
Exactly. And it almost seems like, with the Crosshair that the volume has been turned up on his chip, as we know. And he's, he's so narrow-minded when it comes to that. I mean, he just kept talking about how he's a soldier of the Empire and he's so loyal. And even Rampart asked him, you were stranded for, what was it, like 32 rotations. And that and Crosshair just said it right, 32 rotations. So why did you come back? I'm a soldier of the Empire. And he just doesn't even question it. He's a robot almost, which is insane.
And he's had his chip removed because he told them at the end of last season that he had it removed a long time ago. So he was doing this out of choice, not out of coercion because of any chip was telling him to do it.
That's true.
But let's talk about him for a little bit. So, you made the joke about you having your breakfast interrupted and the episode
poor guy.
introduces him by having him in his quarters and he's got an alarm going off. He gets up, he goes to the mess hall, he gets some food and sits down at a table with two other clones. They immediately get up and go to another table. We saw that they didn't, the Bad Batch didn't necessarily get along with all the other clones at the beginning of last season. But this seems like still an awfully huge grudge to be carrying when the clones are kind of noticing that their numbers are being dwindled. They talk about the defense recruitment bill and how they're hoping that it won't pass because it'll mean bad things for the clones. Yet they're shunning one of their brothers So, you know, what did you make of that beginning for Crosshair?
Well, just exactly what you pointed out, that just that he was always an outlier when it came to everything. And he's even more so now, just because he sticks out like a sore thumb in mm-hmm. more ways than one. And so I think that there's just still a lot of that aggression towards him and Clone Force 99 in general. But you're right. I mean, they really are a dwindling force, so to speak, and you would think that they would stick together more so than anything else. But I just think it was really amazing how they put that focus on how Crosshair is, even though he's a soldier, he's still a human. You know, he still has to wake up with his alarm clock, rub the sleep out of his eyes, head down to the mess hall, try to get his breakfast before he gets interrupted. And, you know, just deal with all of those different kinds of humanity sorts of things that droids don't have to deal with. And that even comes back around at the end when he and Cody are having that conversation about making decisions. And, mm-hmm. you know, we have to live with them. And so, you know, I don't know if that in any way, shape or form got into Crosshair's head at all, because he is acting like a droid. He's not acting like a human.
Yeah, it's a good point. I'm thinking it did. I think it made an impact on him. I think more than anything, it was, you know, I'll read those statements because I wrote them out here. And, you know, when they get back from the mission after Crosshair's murdered Tawni, let's be frank about it. And mm-hmm. Crosshair says, you know, basically asks Cody, or Cody asks Crosshair, is the Empire making the galaxy better? Crosshair's response is, we're soldiers. We do what needs to be done. Cody's response is, you know what makes us different than the battle droids? We make our own decisions, our own choices, and we have to live with them too. And then he wanders off, and Crosshair's just kind of left to ponder that. And then we get another scene of him tossing and turning in bed. And so I don't think it's just that he's sleeping on an uncomfortable cot, Jay. I think
all right.
Mm-hmm. I think he's tormented by things. You know, he was tormented at the beginning of this and he's tormented now. And I think part of it is what you're talking about is, you know, this episode is called The Solitary Clone. And so he's very much an isolated individual amongst the galaxy at large and even amongst his brethren, the clones. Mm-hmm. And he went against his closest brothers in the Bad Batch to stay on Kamino until he got rescued by what's left of the Empire. And I'm just kind of wondering what makes him do what he does. Is he just mad at the galaxy? Or does he really believe in this idea of peace and order that can bring? You know, is it that he really doesn't have any other guiding principle, so he chooses to believe in the Empire so he doesn't have to make those decisions? But, you know, what do you think his motivation is?
Oh, gosh. You know, it could be any number of things, honestly. And, you know, you pointed out the idea of him tossing and turning, and it's obvious that he probably didn't sleep much, if at all, because he was awake before his alarm even went off. And, you know, you also mentioned the whole idea of the solitary clone and the fact that he was alone very much. And those shots of him when he was getting up from his cot, I mean, it almost looked like a jail cell. Mm-hmm. And it's very different contrast from the personalization that they had when they were together. You know, Clone Force 99, they had their little bunks and they had them all kind of personalized and their kits and everything else. And then also, I think another exclamation point for him was when he went in to talk to Rampart, and Rampart was telling him that he's assigned to CTU-1226, and Crosshair says, well, what about Cody? And he says, Cody? Rampart almost like saying mm-hmm. Cody's name, quote unquote, like, how do you have names? You're just numbers, you know? So he doesn't even refer to Crosshair as such. He's just 9904.
Right. Yeah. And it's like seat. And then you can Crosshair's like CT2224.
Right.
And, you know, that's what gets through him. It's like, oh, well, he went AWOL. And, you know, Crosshair has a reaction to that. And, you know, other things, you know, another conversation that comes up earlier in the episode between Cody and Crosshair, you know, they meet at this war memorial and Crosshair doesn't know he's been assigned to Cody yet. And Cody walks up, is like, oh, you know, Crosshair, when I saw that you were activated again, I immediately requested you for my service. And so there was this familiarity and respect that Cody had for Crosshair. But then the topic of Order 66 comes up, and Cody casually throws out there that there are more and more clones that are questioning that order. And Crosshair's response is then, well, then they're traitors, just like the Jedi.
Mm-hmm. And Cody kind of gives this little like side eye.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And he drops it and he moves on. So I'm wondering if that's a clue that, you know, the mention of the Jedi right there, that, you know, what was the arc? There was a couple of them in the Clone Wars where we had, you know, Christophsis, we had the rogue clone that was sabotaging everything so the Separatists could come in, and he was doing it out of against the Republic and the Jedi and the control they had over the clones. And he was going on about how he loved his brothers and the like. And then similarly, Krell, that Basilisk Jedi mm-hmm. general that showed up and was trying to sell out this army by steering them into battles they couldn't win so that he could gain favor with Dooku. You know, is it that type of thing? Is there just a resentment towards the Jedi that fuels Crosshair over all this? Because, you know, he right. certainly didn't hesitate to take a shot at Kanan at the beginning of the series.
Yeah, it's so true. It's so true. Yeah, I think there's a lot going on with Crosshair, a lot more than we've even scratched the surface of. And so I just think it's so awesome that we're getting a little bit more of that psychological profile, I guess you could say, in these mm-hmm. episodes. But before we get off too much on anything else, I wanted to get your thoughts on this one too, as far as the memorial goes. Mm-hmm. And so we've mentioned the fact that they've been in front of this memorial a couple of times, which is the memorial for those that were lost during the Battle of Geonosis. Do you think that that's kind of an interesting thing to have, considering that the Empire, as we were just saying, doesn't even acknowledge clones as people per se, that they don't have memorials for droids that have perished? So how is this memorial still standing, and how is the Empire even allowing this?
Yeah, that was, I'm glad you brought that up. That was a topic I'm going to talk about a little bit too, as I didn't get a chance to stop and read the Arabesh on there. I wanted to, but I'll find some more time later. But I was wondering who built it and why it's there. Is it still around by the time of A New Hope, when it's all said and done? Because most of the clones are pretty much gone by then. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that memorial was an interesting choice. Wouldn't be terribly surprised if it was built by the clones themselves and maybe some help from some Jedi. But, yeah. You know, the end of the episode, you know, that last conversation that Cody and Crosshair are having, Cody's looking right at it and taking it in and thinking about it. And when he asked that question, you know, do you think the Empire is making the galaxy a better place? And he's looking at this memorial that, like you said, memorializes everyone that came before. And Crosshair can't look at it. He doesn't look at it at all. He just looks at Cody when all that's going on. But
yes.
I think yes. Cody's defection had an effect on Crosshair. At least I hope it did. Maybe wishful thinking. But, you know, Cody was someone who executed Order 66. He fired on Obi-Wan Kenobi, or he ordered Obi-Wan Kenobi get fired upon. And now he's questioning the order. And after the actions there on Desix, he goes AWOL. And, you know, I don't know that Crosshair necessarily admires any of the Vregs when it comes down to it, but I do think he had clones like Cody, he held them in high regard. And so I think that's saying something. Now, I guess the counter to that is, well, if Hunter, Wrecker, Echo, and Tech defecting didn't get to him, then why should Cody? But I feel like he's having second thoughts at the end of this one.
Mm-hmm.
Alternatively, I guess the read is that he put his helmet on, he became one of those anonymous people walking around the halls again.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. And there's so much to digest with this. And, you know, there was a few things that you said that I want to point out. One with Crosshair, and you said with him, the rest of the Bad Batch, how did that not have an effect on him? Mm-hmm. Well, I'm wondering if it's just because of the fact that they were in the same gene pool, so to speak, and that he kind of saw them all more as equals. But seeing someone like Cody feeling that way maybe hits a little bit differently for him. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you said that because he's not a quote unquote reg, he was one of those that were on that same kind of level of esteem as Rex. And so this is not just your regular reg, so to speak. You know, it's somebody he maybe holds in a little bit more high regard.
Yeah, that could be it. And yeah, because Cody is a commander. And so, you know, the rest of them aren't.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, a few other things I'd like to touch on before we wrap this up. The animation in this episode was absolutely gorgeous.
Yes.
Just seeing how far they've come from, not that it was ever bad, but the first episodes of the Clone Wars in that season, but the use of shadow and light and blurring effects, things going on in the background, the smoke, the explosions and the ashes in here, just were unlike anything we've seen in Disney animation today. Or Star Wars animation today. Yeah.
Yes, and I was thinking the same thing, even down to there was one scene where you could see kind of through this almost like a screen, and there was a design on the screen, and then it was like a door, and the door opened up or lifted. And then there was another one where the ship was just coming in, and just the way that it was coming in to the landscape itself was just like watching a movie. So I'm glad you brought that up.
Yeah, and then the droidicas in this one were far more lethal than we ever seen them. I mean, that one showed up unrolled and just blasted one of those clones. And, you know, just fast. You know, they've never looked so impressive. Kind of like, you know, when we were talking about General Grievous in Genndy Tartakovsky's Clone Wars versus how he showed up in the Clone Wars.
Yes.
You know, that kind of a difference with them. And then that trick they pulled where they threw the grenade and then Crosshair shot the droid, the battle droid, so it would fall into the shield.
Yeah.
Oh, the droidica so that the grenade could take it out. That was pretty clever as well.
Oh, yeah.
I really appreciated some of the shots. And the way they showed off Crosshair's abilities in this episode, you know, how he stood his ground and kept taking pot shots at the tank until the barrel was pointed right at him. And then he shot right down the barrel to blow up the tank. I thought that was so cool.
Yes, and that was exactly what I was going to say. Could we just stop and just appreciate Crosshair for just a second? And he and Cody together, too, throwing those pucks and, you know, getting in just the way that they were able to work together. It was almost like watching an episode of The Clone Wars. I mean, I found myself actually rooting for them, you know? And because we do have an emotional investment with both of these characters anyway, just from everything that we've seen and everything that we've kind of been through with them. So yeah, I was definitely, you know, rooting for them. And I thought to myself, no, you're not supposed to be doing this. They're the bad guys now. But it was super cool just to revisit that camaraderie. And yeah, Crosshair is just absolutely lethal. And I love how they were like, nice throw, nice shot. was great.
Well, they're definitely the protagonists of this, even though they may not be good guys or are a protagonist. So that's why you kind of find yourself rooting for them. And they're fighting battle droids, which are traditionally the bad guys.
Exactly.
And all this. So, yeah. So I can see why that is. You know, the other thing that just occurred to me was that as they were getting closer to that bell tower, that top floor where they were holding the governor hostage, they ran into the commando droids, and at one point Crosshair has lost his helmet, is being strangled by one of them, and Cody doesn't have his helmet on either, and he pulls out a knife and starts stabbing the commando droid. Do you think perhaps Crosshair saw that and thought of Hunter?
Yes. Oh my gosh. I'm sitting here biting my tongue because as soon as you said the knife, I thought, oh yeah, that was well placed. So bravo. Yeah.
Yeah. Quite an episode. I could go on and on and on about this one. And but I think we've kind of given it its due. Did you have anything else you wanted to add before we wrap it up?
Oh my gosh. Like you said, we could sit here and talk about this for forever because I feel like there's so many different Easter eggs in this. And there's so many different ways that we could talk about like the politics and everything going on behind the scenes and, you know, getting into Crosshair's psyche a little bit more and postulating on where Cody is going. I mean, do you think he's going to go try to find Rex, or do you think he's just kind of like going out on his own? Do you think that maybe we'll get to see Cut again? But Cut and his family they're long gone. But yeah, it's just, there's so many different things we could talk about, but great episode.
That's what Cody's going to happen to Cody. My guess is he's going to reach out to Rex, and Rex is going to call the Bad Batch and have them go get Cody. And I'm basing that solely on what we saw on some of the trailers for this season. When there is that mission, you know, where there's that hologram of Rex, he shows up and, hey, you guys available for a mission? I know Cody's going to show back up again. So that's my guess is what's going to happen with Cody. So
that's a good guess.
We'll see, hopefully some point this season, if that comes true.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Well, then, that was fun, Jay. I'd just like to thank all of our listeners for joining us for this episode of Podcast Stardust and our discussion of the latest episode of The Bad Batch. We hope you enjoyed it. And if you did, please make sure to subscribe to Podcast Stardust on your podcatcher choice. I also like to remind you that you can find all episodes of the podcast over on RichardsApp.com, which is also home to several other great podcasts covering everything from the MCU and DC to Dune, Star Trek, and a whole lot more. As always, we greatly appreciate your 5-star ratings and reviews on whatever podcatcher it is you use, and especially on Apple Podcasts. And please don't forget to share the show and your favorite episodes on social media with your friends. Speaking of which, Jay, can you remind everybody what those social media contacts are one more time, please?
Well, good soldiers follow orders, so here we go. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And you can always catch our Pinterest pages over on the Pinterest app. And we do have a YouTube channel as well with all of our past episodes, as well as some fun unboxing videos. And if you're up for some real-time chatter, you can head over to our Discord room. And we are just one of many rooms on the Wretches Up Discord server. All of the shows have their own rooms, as well as some other really great dedicated rooms to tons of geekery kinds of things. So just go to our show page, click on the community tab, and you are there. And if you are in need of some new swag, you can head over to TeePublic, where we are teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. And we have 7 different show logo designs available on all kinds of apparel and home goods, stickers, cases for your laptops, all kinds of fun stuff. So again, just head on over to TeePublic.
All right. And what's the latest in the world of cosplay?
Well, right now over on my Instagram, which is, of course, j.snipscosplay, having all kinds of fun interacting with everyone in the community. I'm always posting some things on my story with all their kinds of artists and cosplayers and small business owners, and also getting myself into trouble, of course, as Ahsoka, Hera, and the Fourth Sister, with more to come in 2023.
All right. Well, then, that'll do it for episode 516 of Podcast Stardust. Thanks for listening, everyone. And until next time, may the Force be with you.